Welcome back to The Line. A study released by the American Civil Liberties Union determined that New Mexico prisons rank among the highest for the usage of solitary confinement, with rates higher than the state's official reports. UNM researchers based their findings on an evaluation of prison records and a survey of inmates held in isolation. And Carolyn, part of the research sampled a single day in September of 2018, where state officials said the rate of prisoners held in isolation was about 4%. Turned out it was about double that. That's all well and good, the facts of the matter, but here's my question, my first question. We know the science about what happens to people in solitary confinement now. It's not a mystery anymore. How is it that we're still in this place with solitary confinement? It just seems like something we just can't move past at this point. What's it going to take, in your view, to get this moving?
Well, I think it'll take some real type of internal prison criminal justice reform in the state of New Mexico.
Right.
I think this is
going to
be the first of many surprises that we find that are happening in our prisons coming out from underneath the past administration.
Mm-hmm.
I have a personal interest in this personally. I have a son. My oldest son is currently incarcerated and has gone in and out of the prison system.
Mm-hmm.
So I kind of have an eye on that.
Right.
And it's really way more horrible than anybody really knows.
Wow.
So, you know, with this coming out, with just this little tiny sliver, I think you can probably take this and expound it out unmeasurably. You know, the prior administration's corrections department, as you saw from the Santa Fe New Mexicans report, that they actually spent $40 million a year to send people back to prison.
Mm-hmm.
You know, that shows you have a real systemic problem in our prison system.
Right.
So yeah, this, it's probably way more horrifying and it's probably way worse. And on the flip side, you have people in solitary confinement, but then you also have, you know, a room this size with 100 men. So which is better?
Right, thank you. Exactly,
you know,
right.
Which is better?
Exactly.
You know,
right.
And if it's a private prison, where's the oversight?
Mm-hmm. Daniel, when you think about this, we've just now getting, well, it's come up before, but a bill to prevent women, mentally ill adults, and children from being placed in solitary confinement. That's come up a couple of times, if I remember correctly. It just seems like that's a good place to start, wouldn't it? Just kind of chop at this a little piece at a time. Would you agree with that? Is that the best way to go?
You know, first of all, let me tell you, I'm sorry. You know, as a parent, there's nothing worse than that, and I apologize. I'm sorry for that. I think, you know, I'm always torn in this conversation because, you know, we know the horrible effects of using solitary confinement, but we also know that it's supposed to be used in certain instances, right? Because, you know, at times when people are dangerous to other inmates, dangerous to themselves, or there's other inmates dangerous to them, but it seems like we've turned solitary into, you know, a place to do other things based on the reports we're reading.
That's right.
It clearly has an unbelievable effect on the human psyche. I mean, if you don't think so, just take everything you've got, no books, no nothing, go sit in your room, turn the lights off, and sit there for 15 minutes and it'll feel like it's days.
That's right.
You know, but I think it also, I mean, I think that's the tough question that we're constantly dealing with in the state and in this country with prison, right? Is prison a reform place or is prison a detention place? And I think that we've got to figure out a way to meld the two, right? There are people who are never getting out. There are people that you know what? They're truly a menace to society.
Right. They're violent in prison.
And they belong there.
That's right.
But you know, when you watch how today, you know, you can go in for a DWI and be housed for the next 3 weeks with murderers and rapists and drug dealers gang members.
That's right.
I mean, we clearly are breeding super criminals.
That's right.
And so at some point, there's going to have to be a constant or a consistent thought process about, you know, what are we going to do for the detention aspect and what are we going to do for the rehabilitation aspect? And I, you know, I applaud both the governor and the president because, you know, the first step they're taking is, you know, the non-confinement for non-violent drug offenders.
That's the first step
try to turn this around, I think. As far as children and women and stuff, I mean, when you find out that they're locking up young kids,
I know.
They're locking up people with mental illnesses. I mean,
if
you're dangerous to yourself because of a mental illness, locking someone else is doing nothing to help fix the mental illness.
Right.
And we just got to figure out as a society what our philosophy is in prison.
But Eric, therein lies the opportunity, doesn't it? The first corrections secretary, or if that's the proper term, didn't take the job for Governor Grisham, Lujan Grisham, but she could make that a center line of her hiring.
Right.
like, what's your position on solitary confinement? There's an interesting opportunity here, it seems to me.
Yeah, I mean, I think mm-hmm. I mean, getting just building on what others have said, first of all, is mm-hmm. are prisons economic development and, you know, a yep. place for the state and private corporations to make money?
Right.
Are they a place just to sort of park dangerous people? Mm-hmm. Or do we really believe that, like, most of the, at least the democratic world and the developed world, that it's got to be, there's got to be some rehabilitation. Mm-hmm. Whether it's solitary confinement or the respite, like, there is no rehabilitation going on. There are no mental health professionals.
Right.
They're heavily sedated. The dangerous ones are heavily sedated to try to minimize sort of violent crimes and sort of a lot, you know, just try to manage the population. But mm-hmm. if we're serious about mm-hmm. rehabilitating, this is just the edge of what's wrong. Obviously, first of all, those, if you're in solitary, at the very least, we have to invest in getting some really comprehensive mental health, not just
right.
medication, but mental health
that's
and
right.
some kind of rehab. And then that has to be spread to the population. But we're not even doing it mm-hmm. for the folks you're describing, for mm-hmm. folks with mental health issues, for folks who have substance abuse issues. Like, they're just not getting. So what we're doing is we're parking them there for a while.
That's right.
If they don't have another crime committed, which often happens, you know, there's a lot of folks in one place.
Mm-hmm.
If they actually get out, they are usually worse off.
Mm-hmm.
Not a bit better than they
That's
were
right.
when they got in, and
That's
then
right.
we have to deal with them in society.
Right.
It costs
That's
us;
right.
it's more dangerous.
That's right.
As opposed to saying, and I just did the math when I couldn't sleep last night. I was like, what if we for the 7,500 or whatever the number is, what would it cost to have mental health professionals
right.
Actually treat them on a weekly basis?
That's right.
And it's the orders of magnitude of a few million dollars. That's
not
what
much.
We're talking about
right.
here.
Once again, an opportunity, right?
Opportunity.
It's all how you look at these things.
We have $1.2 billion. Why can't we address issues like this? I would like to see so much of our money put into the mental health issues across the state. I think that is really, in many cases, the first step to solve the solution of problems.
Mm-hmm.
I shudder when I think about mentally challenged individuals being placed in solitary confinement. I was served on the Courts and Corrections and Justice Oversight Committee when I was in the Senate, mm-hmm. and so I visited all the prisons and places, and I still get cold shudders when I think about the facilities.
Right.
And I can't imagine being locked up in a single solitary room.
I know.
But back again, we don't have enough space mm-hmm. in the area for the ones we have. But we've got to address mental health in this state across the board in all areas.
Good point there. We'll have to wrap that up for the time being. But we're back in a few minutes to look at efforts to make the Public Regulation Commission an appointed body and not an elected one.